Good morning, Honorable Speaker Professor Pradeep Datta sir, and also I welcome to all the audience of this session. I'm Dr. Jageshwar from National Institute of Foundry and Forge Technology, coordinating this session. Before over to this session on thermal issues and advanced manufacturing, to Honorable Speaker, who has a mastery in the field of thermodynamics and heat transfer, it's my great honor and privilege to introduce our noted eminent Professor Dr. Pradeep Datta sir, Professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, IIT Bangalore. Professor Datta sir completed his graduation B.Tech from IIT Kharagpur in 1983, post-graduation M.Tech from IIT Madras in 1987, and Doctor of Philosophy PhD from Columbia University, New York in 1992. Sir held faculty positions at Columbia University, at the Tennessee Tech University, New York, before joining the Indian Institute of Science as a faculty member in 1996. Sir is the author of more than 200 high impact journal articles in his credit, and also written several books and book chapters. Sir has conducted several seminars in national and international conferences. Sir has also worked in several government sponsored projects, and also continuing one DST project. Sir has guided 26 PhD and 59 master students. Sir has been awarded with JC Bose National Fellowship since 2017 to present. Currently sir is the president of Indian Society of Heat and Mass Transfer, and also a chairman of Solar Task Force DST. Sir has been elected fellow of ASME in 2010, Indian National of Engineering in 2004, Indian Academy of Science in 2011, National Academy of Science in 2014, Indian National Science Academy in 2014, American Society of Thermal and Fluids Engineering in 2020. His current research area is on solar thermal technology, advanced cooling technology, solidification of materials, solidification and metal processing, as well as the computational fluid dynamic. Your research group mainly focus on the development of advanced energy technologies related to the solar energy, cooling of electronics, spacecraft, thermal management, and on thermal technology related to the phase change. Apart from that, sir is an associate editor of ASME Journal of Electronic Packaging and IEEE Transaction on Component Packaging and Manufacturing Technology. It's a proud privilege to have him as a speaker of this session. Thank you, sir. Now over to the session to Honorable Speaker Professor Pradeep Datta sir to further proceed. Sir, please.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the introduction, and thanks to Director Professor Chattopadhyay and all faculty of NIFT for inviting me to give a talk on thermal issues in advanced manufacturing. And as NIFT is now taking a big step, you know, towards becoming an institute of national importance, with a, you know, focus, special focus on manufacturing and materials processing, and it would be the unique institute in the country to take a lead in this, because at this point, you know, if you look at various programs across the nation, manufacturing, there is a big need for a big leap in manufacturing and focus, and so that we can become self-sufficient as a nation, to help the industries also to take a lead in, you know, various aspects of product making and innovation. So manufacturing becomes a key driver in all this. And manufacturing is that kind of a subject which is actually interdisciplinary, because it's very hard to define what is manufacturing. I'll give you an example. It's like, you know, blind man or few blind men trying to describe an elephant. And you know that famous joke about each trying to touch different parts of the elephant and describing the elephant in its own way. So manufacturing is something like that. You ask a machining expert that, so manufacturing is one type, and that becomes the focus. Then there are many other aspects of manufacturing. Even today, the use of artificial intelligence and automation, and that also is geared towards manufacturing. And age-old technique of using, you know, thermal means to achieve the end goal of a manufacturing has been there. And that is now taking a big leap, you know, towards some advanced manufacturing techniques like additive manufacturing, all of you know. So what I am going to do in this lecture is touch upon some of the basics that would be involved in manufacturing which involves heat. And I will take you through some case studies in which we have been involved so that I can talk about it in little more depth. I understand the audience is mostly postgraduate student and faculty, so we can go a little bit into some research issues as well in these topics. But I will show you only a few examples, because those examples we have worked on, but there are many, many other examples of manufacturing where thermal processing is involved. So this is not limited to what I am presenting, but the basics remain almost same. That is where the common thread lies, which would tie up, you know, all kinds of manufacturing in which thermal issues are involved. So I'll go ahead, but meanwhile, if there are any questions on any slide, just you feel free to stop me if there are, you know, real doubts during the presentation. But otherwise, we can keep the questions till the end, and please refer to the slide. Of course, I may not have put the slide number, but once you tell the topic, I will go to that one. So I'll begin now. One second, to advance the slide. So basically, what we are looking at is the role of heat in manufacturing. Are you able to see the slide now? Okay, I'll move ahead. Yes, hello?
Slide is visible, sir.
Okay. Just please let me know whenever, you know, I'm speaking and the slide is not moving, because sometimes these things happen. So role of heat in manufacturing. And if you look at heat, we can put several manufacturing into different categories. One category is where heat is produced during the manufacturing process. And we all know that in machining process, like grinding, polishing, etc., the, I'll just put a pointer. Okay. Yeah, please follow my pointer. The work and the tool materials essentially pass through the zones of transformation, namely plastic deformation, friction, and wear. And I just mentioned these examples. And here, heat is produced. So our job is basically thermal management during these processes. Sometimes, you know, we provide a heat sink so that the temperature doesn't shoot up, or we provide a coolant. Essentially, the objective is to reduce the thermal stresses, residual stresses, and other thermal distortions in the component. That is one category of manufacturing where heat is involved. Another category of manufacturing where heat is involved is that we heat a substance to a certain temperature to aid the deformation process, like materials forming, but without the chip or burr removal. And the examples are rolling, forging, extrusion, drawing, etc. And in these cases, the heated work material only passes through its yield point or yield strength in order to facilitate the plastic deformation. In these cases, we supply heat to aid the process of deformation. So the thermal is only partly involved. Then there are another example where a similar thing happens. That is, we want plastic deformation after we reach an elevated temperature of the workpiece. Friction welding or friction stir welding, there the heat is not externally supplied. It is generated by the friction process itself, but I'm putting that in the same category. And the third category is what is also known as thermal manufacturing. That is, the entire process is heat driven. That involves melting, solidification, phase transformation. And these examples have a wide range, starting with casting, welding, laser processing, and now additive manufacturing, sintering, diffusion bonding, then heat treatment like annealing. So those are basically classified or categorized as thermal manufacturing. And today's talk, I'm going to focus on the thermal manufacturing aspect. So which means that it is primarily heat driven. Now the content, I'm going to the next slide. The content of this talk is going to be heat and fluid flow in welds. We will focus, and a lot of issues will be covered, the basic issues there. Then we go into laser surface alloying, and we also have worked on this laser welding of dissimilar materials, and we'll see the fundamental issues. And then additive manufacturing, just make an introduction, but many of the fundamental issues will be covered in this topic of laser surface alloying, which is an older or precursor to actually additive manufacturing. And then we'll take you through our own experience of end-to-end product development in semi-solid manufacturing, which will cover a lot of thermal aspects. So we begin now with heat and fluid flow in welds. Now the objective of this module or this part of the talk is to provide information of heat and fluid flow during fusion welding, which can strongly affect the phase transformation, microstructure, and properties of the welds. Right. So what the participants can take away from this is they can learn about the types of heat sources, the concept of welding efficiency, heat flow analysis, some melting and solidification aspects, and important thing is some modeling techniques. We will not go very deep into it, but we'll emphasize the importance of the modeling and process simulation, which will lead to prediction, because that is where that exercise gives us an insight into the physics of the problem, which is very important for any process design. Okay. So now we go into, let's say, the types of the welding process. And we all know that there are many types of welding processes, but all of them is involving a joining process. So that the joint is a permanent one, is a permanent joint combining two or more parts, which will involve melting and subsequent solidification of the material. Right? And this will form a strong joint. This assembly is called the weldment, which is a well-known definition of what is a welding and what is a weldment. Now there are two groups of welding processes according to the state of the base material during the weld process. One is the liquid state, where we completely fuse or melt the material. So that's called the fusion welding. The other is called the solid state welding. Okay. And this solid state welding is, there are examples, you know, friction welding is one such. And then there are, of course, diffusion bonding and other types of welding where we completely don't melt. That can also be categorized as solid state welding. Fusion welding is by far the most important category. In fusion welding, the base material is heated to melt. So in this module, again, we'll focus on the fusion welding only. Now, what are the different heat sources in welding? One is the electrical sources, and we are familiar with the arc welding, resistance welding, electroslag. In this particular category of heat source, the heat intensity is about 10 to the power of 6 to 10 to the power of 8 watt per meter square. So this is basically the heat flux. And this heat flux is important. Various types of heat sources will give you different types of heat flux. For instance, laser will also give you another, and different laser processing will involve different heat fluxes. And that will lead to different types of processing. So that's an important parameter to note down, that what is the intensity of heat we are using. And that depends on what kind of material we are also using. Then there are chemical sources like oxyfuel gas welding, thermite welding and all. So here also the heat source intensity is about this order. Now, why we are at the same order is, remember that we are melting the material. So therefore, we need similar kind of heat flux or heat intensity. Then there are high energy sources, which are basically laser beam welding, electron beam welding, and so on. Now, what is the difference between this and the other previous two sources? Is it is not only the heat intensity is high. The important thing here is because you are using a laser, you have the flexibility of concentrating the beam, and you have the flexibility of varying the power. And therefore, your heat intensity is in your control. How much of heat intensity you want, how small an area you want to focus on, that also is in your control, depending on the tuning of the laser. Now, that is something which is not always available. For instance, in the arc welding, those are generally given by the design of the welding process itself. So that's why we are able to reach even higher heat intensity, and we can go into deep penetration as well. Then there are mechanical sources, which are like friction stir welding, where the heat intensity is much lower than that. Heat intensity, of course, is generated by the process itself by friction. And then there is ultrasonic welding. And then there are other sources like the diffusion bonding or diffusion welding. So directly we'll dive into a arc welding process. That's the first category where fusion is important. And what we do is we look into what is there in the arc. Of course, it's a very complex process. The physics of arc is, it will take courses after courses to even understand the physics of the arc process. But what we are interested in the heat part. So let us look at the arc from that angle. This consists of an electrical discharge through a high temperature conducting plasma. So plasma is an important thing in the case of arc welding. And it produces sufficient thermal energy even to the extent it can melt and then join the metal. Gaseous conductor changes electrical energy into heat. In the plasma is a conducting medium. Ion exchange is there, ion flow. And so therefore, there is a good conversion, very high rate of conversion of electrical energy into heat energy. And what it produces is, it produces the heat there itself, but a lot of it is radiation heat. So the characteristics of the ionic gas or plasma is passing through. So typically what we have is, because of this plasma, we have a heat source, which is this plasma or the arc we are talking about. This heat source is a bell-shaped arc. So therefore, it gives you kind of a Gaussian heat distribution with the high intensity at the center, and then it tapers off towards the end. And this is a typical picture of an actual process of an arc welding, where you see a lot of radiation that is wasted. But our aim is, of course, to pass on the maximum amount of heat possible from the generation point to the workpiece, because it's a workpiece which needs the heat. Now, this plasma is at the ionized state of the gas, and is composed of equal number of electrons and ions, which can react to electric or magnetic fields. So there is a cathode terminal and there is an anode terminal. So there again, you can set up your welding accordingly. Again, we'll not go into the details of the arc and that one. Our focus here is on the thermal side. Now there's a solid, then melting, vaporization happens, then ionization of the plasma. Now, what we're interested is in the electrical power that is dissipated to produce the heat. And it's dissipated in the three regions, the anode, cathode, and the plasma column. And this is where, suppose we set it up such that the workpiece is the anode and the arc is the cathode, the electrode is a cathode. And then we have this heat distribution, or rather the power distribution in this manner. So it is distributed in this kind of a bell-shaped curve. So the heat that is generated here, part of it is lost to the surrounding, and then part of it comes into the workpiece, and that is what is important to us. Okay. So the area at the cathode and anode has strong effects on this configuration, and the flow of the heat energy to the terminal that affects the shape and the depth of the fusion zone. So this shape actually will affect what is the heat intensity distribution on the surface of the workpiece, and that will lead to the melting and depth of penetration as well. That of course depends on other parameters like welding speed as well, the scanning speed. Most heat goes into the anode cathode and most is lost radially from the arc. That is what we need to see. Now, what kind of temperature do we realize? The arc temperature can be very high. Depends on the nature of the plasma and current. And this is the type of temperature distribution that is there in the arc. Right. It can go into thousands of degrees. Arc temperature is determined by measuring the spectral radiation emitted. That is how it is measured, and this kind of contours are evaluated. What we are interested in is the energy that is lost. It is lost heat by conduction, convection, radiation, and diffusion through the arc. Now, an important parameter is to determine and estimate also what is the efficiency or the welding efficiency. That means that how much energy we are putting in terms of the electrical energy. We have the voltage E and the current I. So E times I will be the electrical energy that is used. And so the efficiency is determined by the how much of heat that goes into the weld, okay, and how much of energy that is generated by electrical means. So this is, of course, Q, this is in watts. We are multiplying Q multiplied by the time of the weld, but it's the total energy we are looking at, not the power. And EI is the power input. Now, in other, actually this concept of welding efficiency is not just in arc welding, but in other welding techniques such as laser or electron beam welding. In that case, the Q nominal, which is the source, the heat source that is put in, is the power of the heat source of the electron beam in the case of electron beam. And in the case of laser beam also, what is the power that we are putting in, respectively. Okay. Now, welding efficiency, we many times ignore, but when we are modeling or trying to understand or predict the process of welding, the depth of penetration and so on, the welding efficiency is an important parameter to consider, because that is what gives you the actual heat that goes into the workpiece before you can start predicting how much of melting or how quickly it will melt and what is the depth of penetration. So this is a welding efficiency, you know, is too difficult to determine theoretically or by prediction. It's generally determined by measurements. And these measurements are very simple measurements. Using calorimetric method. Okay, we use a calorimeter and a simple setup of this kind is used. Like this is a welding process, and you know from the power dissipation from the electrical source how much of energy that you are putting in. And below the workpiece, you run a water in, water out. And under steady state condition, this change in temperature of the water multiplied by m dot Cp will give you how much of heat actually is taken by the workpiece. So under steady state condition, we'll be able to find out from this T out and T in of this water, okay, how much of heat transfer that goes into the thing. And then of course it's a simple exercise of calorimetric measurement and then determining how much of Q that goes in. And then we can use our efficiency formula to find out the efficiency. And then there are typical efficiencies also we need to know in various welding processes. And these typical efficiencies are, in the case of, as you will see, that they are nearly about 80%. And of course, in laser beam welding, it is, you see, very, very less. But if the reason is that a lot of it can be reflected. So what we do is we do surface modifications and so on to make the efficiency high enough to touch a similar level of efficiency. Right. So that's something that I just no need to go through the details of all these things, but it is enough to know that it's hovers around the range of 70-80%. It is possible to design a system. The analysis of the heat flow in welding, temperature distribution occurs during the welding greatly affect the microstructure of the weld. And this is an important thing. Not only at the heat affected zone, but also in the weldment where it undergoes solidification, what kind of microstructure formation, what kind of macro segregation that happens, that affects the quality of the weld. Okay. And if you see here a typical temperature distribution, as the weld pool, well, this is the in the direction of motion of welding. Okay. And this is how the isotherms, they are distorted, you know, in this direction. So most of them are elliptic shaped isotherm. But the temperature contours, if you see, there's the highest temperature lies where just below the arc. And or in the case of laser, it will be similar profile. Okay. And if you do a sectioning here longitudinally, okay, anyway, the as the heat source moves on, the cooling rates around the weld are very high. That's another thing. And these cooling rates also determine the kind of microstructure that are forming, the grains that are forming, okay, in the weldment as it solidifies and also in the heat affected zone. Okay. A more intense heat source will give a steeper profile and the heat affected zone, which will be confined to a narrower region. So what happens is if this is very intense, so you melt something, and if the arc is not heating the adjoining areas too much, then there will be a narrower heat affected zone. This is well known to everyone. Effect of temperature gradient on the weld microstructure is an important aspect. Substantially higher than in the casting processes. Casting is a much slower process. This is a much faster process in terms of heating as well as cooling. This leads to high solidification rates, which produce finer dendriting microstructure than observed in most castings. And if you do it well, many times the weldment mechanical properties can even be better than the parent material. That's something that also is well known. So there are, you know, different, if you see here that the different parts, the weldment, of course, goes under complete melting and solidification. And the heat affected zone, there are, depending on the level of heat cycle or the cycle that they go through, there are other phase transformations which happen. Okay. Okay. Now, what we do is we go into modeling of the welding process. In the modeling of the welding process, of course, I will not go into very much details of all the equations and everything. But what I'll try to present is what are the physics that go into a modeling so that we can understand the physics of the process. And today, there are enough, you know, software and everything available, especially dedicated software like SysWeld that are available so that you can simulate any welding process and get the time temperature history and microstructure prediction, everything you can get if you want. So, and there are, you know, microstructure software also like Micres that are available, that once you give the parameters, process parameters, it will give, it predict the microstructure. So don't worry about learning how to model, but understanding the physics of the problem is an important thing. So what we do here is, this is just a, like a simplest example is like a butt weld, where there are two materials, and this is where the process will go through, the electrode will pass along this line, XYZ coordinate. An important part is the modeling of the heat source. Of course, Q is equal to the eta is the welding efficiency times V times I in the case of arc welding, we know. And this is a typical Gaussian heat source. And it is spread, the heat is spread over the region between R equal to zero here at the center line to R equal to RQ, we say is the radius of the arc. It's a nominal value, of course, up to which, beyond which it becomes insignificant, the less significant the heat. So like any Gaussian curve, there is a standard deviation beyond 2 sigma, 3 sigma, it will not make much of a difference. So here is the representation of such a heat source as a function of R. Of course, when R equal to 0 is where the maximum heat source is. Okay. And this is a Q, that is a flux, that is after we factor in the welding efficiency. Then there are governing equations I will not go through, but because we are involving melting solidification, there is a fluid flow equation in terms of mass conservation and momentum conservation. In addition, we have energy conservation to look at the heat flow along with the fluid flow to give us the temperature contours with time. Okay. And because there may be other species involved, because it is undergoing melting solidification, there can be macro segregation. And this is more important in the case of dissimilar welding than similar welding. So with this background, we also bring in other submodels. These submodels in the model is melting, which will have melting solidification, micro segregation model like Lever rule or Shiles equation, etc. I'll not go into those details, but just enough to know that what it involves, so that when you use any software, you will understand what are the models that are behind the software, which are hidden like a black box. But you'll be able to use them appropriately in that case. Then a little bit on the weld pool convection. Now, weld pool convection is created not just by natural convection of a heated melt pool. Most of the convection is actually created by, one is by what is known as surface tension driven convection, that is Marangoni. I'll spend a little bit, 1 minute on this one. Surface tension driven convection, why it happens? It happens because that surface tension itself is a function of temperature. The sigma is a function of T. Now we have a very high temperature gradient. That means your del T del X, right? If that is very high, and if the surface tension itself is a function of temperature, that leads to a high surface tension gradient. That is del sigma del T. Okay. Now for most metals, this surface tension gradient is negative. That is your del sigma del T is less than zero. Pure metal, it is like that. Which means that the liquid, why surface tension actually causes a flow? Because liquid has a tendency to be pulled in the direction of decreasing temperature. So which means that it will be pulled from the center of the pool to the edge of the pool with a very high force, right? So this is the typical heat source distribution and the typical velocity. You will see that from the center to the edge of the pool it comes in all directions. It is shown in 2D only. And to the extent, for the kind of temperature gradient we are looking at in the case of this welding, very high temperature gradient. So this, even to the extent of 1 meter per second in such a small pool, which is of the order of centimeters, centimeter diameter, a little bit more, it can lead to very high velocities. This, now, when this radially outward flow happens at such a high velocity, it tries to spread the heat towards the periphery, and that would lead to shallow and wide pool. But in metal arc welding, we many times see that the weld pools are actually deeper than what is predicted by this kind of, you see, the velocities. So what happens in case of a steel, we have surface active elements. And these surface active elements, like the case of sulfur, for instance, okay, this surface active, once it is there, see, I'll just show you that. Okay, this is the typical, before I go into the surface active element, this is a typical del sigma del T. When it is less than zero, it leads to the shallow pool. And when the surface tension gradient is positive, then what happens is liquid is pooled inside. So it gives a narrower but a deeper pool. Now comes the function of surface active elements. And typically, you know, if you have something like sulfur, and with parts per million of that, then the surface tension coefficient actually keeps changing with the concentration of or this parts per million concentration of sulfur. Then what happens is it alters the gradient from negative to positive in case it is in this range. And that typically happens that if something like a 10 ppm of sulfur is there, you will get a shallow pool, which is predicted by this kind of a situation, okay, because of the fluid flow outside from center to the periphery. But if you have about 150 ppm of sulfur, you will get a narrower and deeper pool. And this has been experimentally observed. So this also goes into our model. Okay, then what happens is, other is the electromagnetic force. We also calculate electromagnetic force, because which is also called the Lorentz force. And we solve equations to find out what is the electromagnetic force, which is J cross B. So this is also solved in the same domain. And there are, of course, software, and sometimes it can be built in our fluid flow software. So you don't have to do much of programming. You know, 30 years back, 20, 30 years back, when we used to do, we had to code in everything, all the physics separately and then combine them. But today things are much simpler. It is, at least to get started, it is enough to understand what goes into the model than to start modeling everything. So this is the force distribution, which will, this force distribution typically is from the periphery to the center. So this actually tends to make it a deeper and narrower pool. So this is a sectional view, and this is just a force distribution, not the liquid movement necessarily. So with all these ingredients, we go into again our domain, where this is the molten pool, and this is the direction of welding, and this is a solidified layer, as you see, we want to predict. And then we give all kind of thermal boundary conditions, insulated conditions somewhere. And on the top of the pool, of course, we are giving a boundary condition depending on the that surface tension effect. So that will cause the heat flow. And all other body force term, which comes from the Lorentz force calculation, that also goes in. And then once the simulation starts, the melting solidification submodels also come into the picture. And then finally, we get a prediction. So let us look at one case study that we have done, which is that gas metal arc welding, which is basically our MIG welding. Now, this is more complex than the TIG welding, of course. In this, we also have a melting electrode consumable, which goes into this pool. And this melting electrode also is difficult to predict, because this arc actually melts. So part of the energy goes into the melting of the electrode, and then there are drops droplets which impinge on the pool. That affects not only the energy transfer but also the distribution of heat inside the pool, which will lead to generally a deeper weld pool. Okay, so all these complexities are there. So in this particular case, the modeling we divide into three modules. The first module is the electrode analysis. That is the melting of the electrode, and we want to calculate what is the enthalpy of the molten droplet. That has a submodule which has to be added on. Then what happens is we also want to predict how much of Lorentz force or the electromagnetic force, and this gives us the body force term. And then they all combined into one weld pool model where we are giving all these as input. Thermodynamic, thermophysical properties, workpiece dimensions, current, voltage, torque, speed, etc. We solve all the equations, and what we get is temperature field, velocity field, weld pool, shape and size. And so this is basically all things combined. So let us start with the first module, that is electrode analysis. There are many different types. What we have done is we have adapted something from this key metal, where essentially what is happening is the Joule heating and electron condensation. So that physics is much more complex than what we can deal with in this course. But we take the essence of it. Can we predict based on the given parameters like voltage, current, and the other arc parameters, welding parameters, can we predict the Joule heating and whatever the heat source that comes in? That is one thing. And that is, there are empirical relations which are available, which we use. And then we finally predict what is the droplet mass flow rate or electrode wire melting rate based on that. And for that, we model the heat transfer within the electrode as a conduction dominated heat transfer. And then what we predict is based on the current, we are predicting the droplet temperature. And we find out that with increasing current, we are having higher and higher droplet temperature. Okay. Then that is one thing. And we are able to predict that for a steel electrode wire, which has a radius of 0.8 mm, and argon as a shielding gas, and with this range of current, the droplet heat energy, that is the heat energy absorbed by the droplet, is about 27 to 30% of the total energy input by the source, which means that we are left with about 70% of it. So part of it will go into directly into the workpiece and part will be lost to the surrounding. So this is the energy balance that we are looking at. Of course, this Lorentz phase calculation I just showed is the same as before. And then what happens is, of course, I don't have the animation here. It was getting complicated to produce it here. But we predict actually the droplet formation, then droplet impingement. And as it impinges, if there is a pool like this, how it deforms the pool and temporarily. And then the energy can directly penetrate deeper into the pool as a result of this one. And then, of course, the surface deformation happens, and ultimately, it there will be a bulge over here. Once the but with continuous droplet impingement, of course, there is a deeper and deeper penetration of the heat energy that happens during this impingement. And then we do the weld pool thermal modeling with all this, then invoke the turbulence model, then look at the surface tension on the weld pool geometry and so on. And I will not go, it is the same thing. And then let's look at the total outcome. The outcome over here is what we are able to predict is the weldment area, okay, with all the heat and fluid flow. Then there is a heat affected zone. So we we do some prediction. And then we also compare with experiments. And what we see is that there is some good match as far as depth is concerned. But of course, I'd like to caution you, and I'll repeat this over and over again. The purpose of this modeling is not to, you know, try to do an exact match with the experiment. That we can never do, because the real process is far too complicated and there are many other factors that we may be neglecting. And that is why if we can only capture the most important physics and put that in the model, at least what we can do is we can predict the trends, that if you vary this parameter, is the pool going to be deeper or shallower? To what is the order of magnitude of the whirlpool depth? What is the heat cooling rate finally experienced by the weldment during solidification? Can we predict the nature of grains? All these, so that is where, you know, even advanced modeling will be able to predict porosities, whether it is happening or where it may happen. But we cannot exactly pinpoint every location and all the details of this. So as long as it produces a trend, and if the trend matches, we should be happy that at least our model is able to give us guidance towards designing an experiment. So that is the extent to which a model should be. So do not listen to the claims of many of these software providers. They will tell you that our model can do everything. It can predict up to the second decimal place what is going to happen. These processes are too complex for us to understand and produce. So that is what this, as long as there is a reasonable agreement, is good enough. Okay, so now what we do is we shift towards laser processing, and a couple of examples I'll give. One is laser surface alloying, and the other is laser welding of dissimilar material. Again, we have done from a modeling angle, and then we have done some experiments to validate whether the model is predicting or not. So that the model should have a predictive capability and nothing more than that. And that will lead to just a little bit of introduction on the additive manufacturing. I'm not an expert on that one, but we have done some work earlier on laser processing, which I'm going to present now. Now, there are many applications of laser processing, and I'm not an expert on lasers. So what I will be presenting is mostly from the heat transfer angle or the thermal angle. There are experts in lasers who we consult sometimes to get some input for that. So laser processing application, of course, depending on the heat intensity. Again, this is the heat flux. And remember that now we are coming down to watt per centimeter square, because now the heat intensity is much higher. At a much lower heat intensity, what we do is laser surface hardening. It's a surface processing. And in that, because we are not melting, what we encounter, the mode of heat transfer is only conduction. And of course, there may be some other phase transformation that may be happening. Okay. Now, laser welding, of course, goes into a higher intensity of heat source. And like the case of the other arc welding, we are experiencing, or we experience, Marangoni convection, and the kind of temperature gradient that we encounter, we have velocities on the order of 1 meter per second almost. And laser surface alloying also has a similar range of heat transfer, where we have to melt the pool, but we also introduce a powder. Okay. These are, you know, precursors to additive manufacturing. We can introduce powder into the pool to alter the properties of the surface. And that leads to Marangoni convection. And also, because we are putting a powder of a different material, there is a concentration of the species which we have to track. And that is where the mass transport comes into the picture. Okay. And then they go for even higher power level, you know, power intensity level, then we go into laser drilling. which involves even up to vaporization or plasma formation. Okay. So first, let us start with this laser surface alloying, which we will go through. We'll not go through all the processes, only the alloying we'll do. And maybe welding a little bit. And in this particular case, what we are doing is we are moving the laser from in the X direction here, like the way it is shown. And this is the laser. And then simultaneously we are putting in a powder so that there is a melt pool here and the powder here melts and mixes. And then finally the layer that is produced will have a different property. And typically the properties are desirable properties and we can target any properties that we want. So this process in that case offers a lot of flexibility, both in terms of choice of material for the powder and also the choice of processing condition under which we will get different properties of the surface. So we can do the scanning all over a particular surface to produce a material which will have a like a coating, it will have special properties. So enormous flexibility it can give us. Okay, now let us see what are the issues in this laser surface alloying. Of course, the objective is, as I just mentioned, is to improve the surface properties. Fluid flow in the melt is primarily driven by Marangoni convection, just like in the case of arc welding, which we have seen. And here the heat, momentum, species transport, they occur simultaneously. So modeling will involve, just like before, all these. And there may be moving heat, so there will be a moving heat source. So we have to account for it, melting, mixing because we are putting in another powder which will melt, solidification. Then some cases intermetallics can also form during the solidification process, and that is what we need to watch out for, and that is the domain of our materials engineers, material scientists. Again, I'm not an expert on all these phenomena, but in any of these, as mechanical engineers or manufacturing engineers, when we want to do some things like this, I think we should always consult or collaborate with materials experts, because that is an important input. Without that, we'll not be able to understand. It is not just heat and fluid flow and transport. There are, you know, so many things which are happening at the materials level, not just phase transformation, even formation of these intermetallics. And these are complex processes. And thermodynamics involved, which may be outside our domain as mechanical engineers. Then final species distribution microstructure depend on this transport phenomena, as I just mentioned. And what happens is we have a base material and we have a powder. Now the melting points of that alloying element or the powder, and there may be, it may be different from that of a base metal. And that should be considered. And we will show you two extreme examples to show that how modeling can change depending on the relative melting points of the alloying element and the base metal. And the final pool that forms and the material that forms also, or rather distribution of the species also depends on that. Our aim is to develop computational model to predict the macroscopic features of the process and predict microstructure formation resulting from the process, right? So let us now go into the computational modeling, which is very similar to the previous modeling that we have shown. The objective is again to understand the physics of the process and predict the outcome based on the process parameters. Again, it's a very similar modeling setup is there. And there's no different from what we saw in the case of arc welding, except that the heat source is different here. And we will input another species over here. So that has to be also in the mass conservation, or rather species conservation equation. This flux also has to come into the picture, flux of the species. We will go into that later. Again, the governing equation is the same as before, except that we now also have a species conservation, the segregation of the species. And we need these submodels as usual. I'm not dwelling much onto this one, it's the same as before. Now look at the boundary condition on the top surface. There is a laser heat that comes in. Then there are heat losses. One is the convective heat loss to the surrounding. There is, depending on what kind of environment we are doing the process. And then there is radiative heat loss because there's a high temperature involved, especially near the center. So we can get a large amount of radiation heat loss. And then the heat absorption inside the metal, it comes through a conduction from the top side. And then, of course, once it goes into the molten pool, it goes mixed, the heat gets carried by convection. But the initial, at the surface interaction is, there is a gradient, temperature gradient, which puts the heat inside the pool. Now, there's a Gaussian heat input again for the heat source. In this case, it's a laser. Then there is Marangoni convection, just like before, caused by the temperature gradient, which causes surface tension gradient. And liquid is pulled in the direction of decreasing temperature. And here we are not considering any surface active element to alter this surface tension gradient. The velocity boundary condition also on the top of the pool, because of the surface tension, we have this which leads to the velocity gradient and that causes the motion. I will not go deep into this, but these are all straightforward conditions that are put based on the physics. So we have the boundary condition, energy conservation of velocity, energy and everything that is put in the standard form. There's nothing like this one is from the walls. It is a convective heat loss from the wall of the workpiece we are talking about. And the top condition we have already given in the previous slide here, both velocity and as well as temperature. So now all the other sides, the conditions are given, which are straightforward. The important thing here is the species condition. Now, we have to make an assumption here. Are we assuming that all the powder particles that we are putting in, they will melt instantaneously at the top surface or not? Is it valid or not? That depends on the relative melting temperature. And m dot here is the powder feed rate. Mf is a powder feed rate. And so we do a flux, which is m dot, divided by the area over which the powder is distributed. And then we give species boundary condition, one at the solidification front, one at the melt front, and on the top surface species condition is the, this is the because of the powder entry rate. Now this powder entry rate, if all of it is melting instantaneously on the top surface, now when will that happen? That will happen when we have the melting powder which is put in, the melting point is much lower than the base material. So it will almost instantaneously melt, and therefore this is the condition, flux condition that we can put in. But this condition will not be valid if we do it the other way, that the powder melting temperature is much higher, then the powder will be put in, will be convected in the pool, and then it will be advected in the pool, and then it will melt progressively, and then there is a distribution of this source species source term. So the source term will get distributed depending on where the particles are moving and as they progressively melt. And finally, when they melt totally, there will be no other heat source, species source. So species source get distributed. That is what we will see in this second example. So let us go to the first example where we are alloying aluminium on nickel base metal. So nickel melting temperature is much higher, aluminium is lower. So therefore all of it will be, powder will be melting on the aluminium. So we are just taking an example, alloying of aluminium on nickel. So this is, these are the melting temperature differences between for nickel, and this is the for the aluminium. Okay. And this is the corresponding phase diagram that is used, which will be required for the solidification process and macro segregation. So this is basically the solidus, starting from aluminium, your nickel melting point is 1455, aluminium is 600. And so this is the nickel composition as it is varied from zero. So zero nickel, pure aluminium, it is melting around 600 degrees Celsius. So this is the phase diagram. And these are, again, when we compute with a laser power of 2700 watt, let's not look at the results or anything like that. Let's look at the kind of velocity profiles and everything that is provided and the kind of pool that is formed. It's nothing more than that. And this is the speed of the laser. 0.013 meter per second, which is basically 13 millimeter per second, basically. Okay, so now these are the, again, temperature distribution as we see here. And what we have put here in the temperature contours, you see the this contour is 660, which is the melting point of aluminium, and this contour is 1455 is the melting point of nickel. But of course, what is existing here is a mixture of both, is an alloy of both in different composition, concentration distribution. And same thing over here, we just darken these two contours of the two material melting point. So the pool will go all the way to, say, even pure aluminium it can have. So that's how it, potentially it can be the depth of the pool, depending on what composition we have at any point. Okay, now this is again the concentration fields what we have after being at the melting front. So this is from the top view. We have the solidification front on this side, and this is the melting front. The scanning is in this direction. And this is the side view or longitudinal view. This is the melt front, this is the solidification front. And if you see the species distribution, of course, because we are putting aluminium in nickel, this is the aluminium concentration that we are looking at. Of course, as it is in the melt front, more of nickel gets melt, so the aluminium concentration is very low. And towards the back, the aluminium concentration is higher. And right at the center, of course, on the pool, there is some concentration of aluminium, as we see here in this cross-sectional concentration. So anyway, we are able to predict, and of course, parametric studies can be done. That is variation of well pool depth and well pool width with scanning speed. And as scanning speed is more, you see, we get a shallower pool. That is understood because the penetration will be less. And the width will also be less in that case, because the per unit time, the heat that is going into the workpiece is less because as the scanning speed is higher. But with lower scanning speed, we get higher depth. That is again intuitive. Okay. Now what we see is that this is something which is predicted, and this is the melt pool. And this is what we finally see as a microstructure. Kind of trend, what we see, the pool depth is similar to what is there in the experiment. Okay. Now, so to validate the experiment, what we do is we look at the composition distribution. Now, composition distribution, again, we cannot match it exactly. But what we do is we take the along the depth, for instance, the non-dimensional depth, that is depth divided by the maximum depth, because the depths that are predicted by the model is different, little bit different from the depth that is predicted by the experiment, or not predicted, by observed in the experiment. So what happens is we do a normalized depth and look at the composition or species distribution, that is aluminium atomic percentage we see. And what we see is that at a high scanning speed, of course, the depth will be quite low. And this is the kind of distribution that we see. and at a low speed, we look at this kind of composition. Of course, it is understood that the concentration of aluminium will be more in the case of lower speed, because for the same feed rate, more will actually go into the pool, because the as the laser is traversing, you know, there is more time, the resident time of the, or rather per unit time, the more powder will be in the pool. So we get a higher concentration, and this is distribution. So more or less the prediction, at least we are able to get some trend predicted. Now, the other, if we do the other way, we do nickel on the aluminium, of course, the melting point of nickel is much higher than the melting point of aluminium. Then what happens is assumption of a mass flux on the surface is not valid, because it will progressively melt as the particles go through the pool. So the modeling strategy would involve another step here, that is particle tracking, okay, and particle melting. So at the particle scale, we do this exercise, and then we predict what would be the distributed melting pattern, and that will go into the model module A. So this is, I don't want to describe too much, but this is the algorithm that we follow. But essentially this is what we do. We will do this and then feed it into this one. And if we do that, then again, we have the prediction of all this. That is nickel on the aluminium. And we do some prediction of the pool and the solidified microstructure. If you see here, again, it's difficult to get one-on-one prediction because we are not able to measure the temperatures also, but look at just the shape of the pool down below is a similar shape that we have. But the composition is where we wanted, we find that it makes a difference. And in this composition, what we see is, I will just show you that these circles are actually what we see in the experiment. And what we are plotting is, we are plotting normalized composition of nickel versus distance from the bottom of the solidified melt. From the bottom of the solidified melt pool, this is at the bottom and this is at the top. Again, it's a normalized one. And what we see is that these are the circles that are obtained from the experiment. These are experimental values. And these stars are what we get numerical with the source term modification. That means that we are considering the particle tracking and progressive melting of the particle as it goes through the pool. And if we do that, we get a reasonable match here. But had we taken the previous model where all the mass flux or the CC's flux were at the top, and without the source term modification, CC source term modification, we would have got a completely reverse prediction. So this is again shows the power of these models and prediction is actually, if we put in the right physics, at least we'll be able to predict the trend. That's all that is required. So with that, now I'll just spend a few minutes on this laser welding of dissimilar material. And here again, two metals are there. Dissimilar material welding is very complex process actually. But what we will do is we will advocate that as far as the laser is concerned, it is the same type of laser. So that modeling is not changing. But what is changing here is that as the melt pool is created, now these two materials will mix with each other and then solidify. Now that is very hard to model and very hard to predict microstructurally also, experimentally, what is going to happen. So a little bit of physics we want to put in, but what we do is we start with a simple model. Because dissimilar properties are also there, thermophysical properties. And all these complexities are there. Along with that, this gets added. So what we do is, in actual case, if the two fluids are immiscible, rather two metals or alloys we do, if they are partially miscible or immiscible, then it is very hard to predict. So what we need in that is a two fluid model, which is more complex. So we wanted to, and then there may be a large change in density and so on. Also, more modeling complexities are there. So we wanted to start with a very simple system like copper nickel, which are completely miscible with each other. And in that case, we can use a simple model, which is called the homogeneous model, called the mixture model. That, and in mixture model, the phase diagram is also very simple of copper nickel, I will show you. And then we can use mixture properties according to mass fraction of each species. And then only one set of conservation equation, and then we can use our previous model. So this is just to begin this kind of a study. So this is the typical copper nickel phase diagram, and these are the thermophysical physical properties. If you look at the phase diagram of this is again zero nickel, and this is 100% nickel, this is 100% copper. You will see that they are completely miscible with each other. And if we apply now the properties, thermophysical properties, as we see here, the densities are also not too far apart. So we can use our usual model. Otherwise, model also has to change. Melting points are different, definitely. Thermal conductivities. This is maximum difference actually in the thermal conductivity or thermal diffusivity. Maximum. Specific heat, not much of difference. But and this is where the major difference comes. And I will show you how it comes. So again, modeling will have the same kind of input. I will not go into the thing because it is same as that of a laser surface alloying. And again, normally when we do laser welding, there are two types of welding depending on the weld speed or heat intensity. For low speeds and high heat intensity, we typically get a keyhole type of arrangement. Now this is much harder to model, and to first understand the dissimilar metal welding, we didn't want to go into this kind of process. We wanted to focus on what is called a more, there's a conduction mode welding, or basically it will not form the keyhole, but it will form a pool. And then we want to look at this microstructure and prediction of the pool. So we'll focus on this one. And this is achieved at a higher scanning speed so that the effective intensity is lower. And then what we do is we have copper, we have nickel, and we predict this fluid flow, you know, top view, then the side view, and then we look at the temperature contours. And so this is the melt pool size that we have, and this is the pool that is predicted as the laser is moving. Okay, so with that prediction, of course, another thing that we note, this of course we could not predict, that interface microstructure, copper side, there is a problem. On the nickel side, it is better. And the main reason is, the copper side has a higher thermal conductivity. And when you are introducing the laser, the portion which has higher thermal conductivity, the temperature gradients will not be much. As a result, what happens is that the melting is improper, and so we don't have a good mixing at the copper side, because the temperature reached is not very high. On the nickel side, it is better. But anyway, we just move on. But we look at the composition profiles, we see a good trend here that on the experimental and computational and experimental, we have a good match here. So, but again, we are not trying to do one-on-one match, but we are just looking at the trend, that is distance across the weld pool versus the nickel weight fraction. And I mean, the kind of distribution at the top and the, I mean, depending on the location, that is the only thing that is predicted. And we were happy enough to, as a first step. But anyway, let us look at now quickly. I will go into the now with all this laser processing, it has led to a new manufacturing technique called the additive manufacturing. So I'm not an expert and I will not go into the deep into it. But in the additive manufacturing, what we do is we make layer by layer from 3D CAD data. And this is different from material removal or traditional subtractive manufacturing. So what we do is we produce a part layer by layer like this. And this deposition is done usually through laser processing and melting of powder. Okay, and this is what is called, one of the variants is called the powder bed fusion or PBF. And it can be laser powder bed fusion or electron beam powder bed fusion, depending on the heat source. That it depends on the powder delivery also. Powder can be a deposition or directly directed energy deposition, DED. So it depends on how it is fed. Very much similar to the laser surface alloying that we saw. So basically from powder, we make a part. That is the nutshell of additive manufacturing. And as you see here in this schematic, there is a melt pool. Convection and radiation losses will be there. And a laser beam. And then there may be melt pool is created by powder which is already deposited here. That is one way. Or the other way is that powder is fed during in the laser directly. Whichever way it is still melting and solidification, similar to what we saw. And this is the melt pool. So the dynamics are similar to what we saw in laser surface alloying. So a large part of that physics can be brought in here, and one can do with the thing. So that brings me to the end of this part, and I'll spend another, can I have another 10 minutes or so, or?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, sure,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, so with another 10 minutes I'll finish. And the last part I will do is, which we have gone through from end to end. So far what we have shown, those processes are just to understand the physics, and we were not looking at products. The last part, because you know this is a community of NIFT and manufacturing, I wanted to give an example. And of course, NIFT is famous for forging. So this is also a kind of forging, the semi-solid manufacturing. In this particular case, we have gone through the process of the very basic concept to final product design and product making. So I want to share that experience with you. And this involves, in all stages, it involves thermal processing. And that is what we will share with you. Now, some of you may be already familiar with what is semi-solid manufacturing. Essentially, the idea is to create a non-dendritic microstructure as against dendritic microstructure, which is formed during casting or even other solidification during die casting. That leads to leads to defects and also the loss in mechanical properties. So how we achieve this non-dendritic microstructures? One way is by vigorous stirring of the liquid metal during the solidification process. Initially, of course, it was invented in MIT accidentally with lead tin alloy. But now it has gone to much more advanced level where we can design an experiment with any kind of metal right now with this kind, as long as there is a difference between liquidus and solidus temperatures. Processing in the semi-solid state leads to the non-dendritic microstructure. Thixotropic behavior, I will explain what this is. It's a non-Newtonian fluid kind of a behavior where if you apply more shear, it actually, there's shear thinning. So the flow will be even better in that semi-solid state. So which leads to the ability to cast into complex shapes with application of moderate forces because of the lower viscosity as you apply the force. That happens in the semi-solid state. And I will explain to you in the next couple of slides what this is, okay. Before that, let us look at the two major variants of this semi-solid processing. One is, in one case, what we do is we take an ingot, typically let's say of aluminium alloy, and we melt. And then in the melt, we do stirring by mechanical means or any other means, we do stirring. And this stirred metal is partially solidified here, which means that that it is in the semi-solid state, and directly this semi-solid slurry is injected into or transferred to a die casting machine, and we can get a cast product. Okay, and this is how it happens. The other process, which is a more involved process, but there are advantages also in this one, is called the thixo casting process, in which what we do is we go through the partial melting condition, that is after stirring, and then solidify the slurry into billets. And these billets can be produced and kept for future use. And then at the location where you want to do die casting with semi-solid manufactured billets, you transfer those billets there. Then you cut the billets in the right sizes. And then what we do is we can do reheating, typically with an induction heating furnace, reheating up to the semi-solid or solidus temperature, reheating up to that one so that it partially melts. And then this partially melt billet is put into the die casting machine and cast into the final product. So what we'll do is I'll take you through the example of a thixo casting process that we developed, which will be explained here. Now, typically in a thixo casting process, we do first is the melt stirring. And this melt stirring can be, one way to do is electromagnetic stirring, and other ways also like cooling slope, shear induced, many other processes are there, which introduces shear into the fluid. And when we do the stirring and then solidify while it is being stirred, then there are these dendritic particles which can be sheared away and broken. And so the slurry becomes a mixture of dendritic particles and the remaining liquid. And as the solidification progresses, right, the remaining liquid comes to the eutectic state, okay, and solidifies. So finally, what we get is, we get a microstructure where that remaining liquid finally solidified into an eutectic phase. So there is an eutectic phase, and these other phases, which are called alpha phases of aluminium, these are the broken dendrites. From that, so in the final solidified microstructure, we have a primary phase where we have these the primary phase which were created by the broken dendrites, and the secondary phase which is the eutectic. As against, you see here, the eutectic phase is what is continuous here. As against a normal dendritic microstructure, your dendrites are more continuous, whereas the eutectic phase is not continuous. So what happens is, in this particular case, when you partially melt up to the eutectic temperature, the eutectic phase will melt. What happens is, then if you apply any force, these particles can easily roll over and into any shape that we want. And it can even be cut like a butter. So the flow resistance at high solid fraction is quite low. And it is shear thinning property it has. So it can be cast into any products of desired size. So this is basically the same steps as I just mentioned. That is slug cutting, then slug heating, and then of course into the die casting. This will come into later. But let us look at the kind of applications of semi-solid manufacturing that has been now realized. Of course, we can get near net shape manufacturing as a result, because the surface finish is quite good, and there is less wastage also, and also hardly any porosity, no solidification shrinkage. So from automobile parts to aircraft parts, it can be done. But of course, the process is generally more expensive than normal casting. So we typically restrict it to safety critical parts where cost is not a major factor as yet. This is the application. And we have first developed stirrers, electromagnetic stirrers, which has different range of, we need to produce electromagnetic forces actually to do the stirring. So the kind of current and voltage that is required is also sometimes quite high. So we first produced this kind of electromagnetic stirrer. And with that stirrer, we produced some billets. And these billets were tested while certification was going on. And you'll see that the cooling curves with stirring is different from the cooling curves that are without stirring, because we do controlled experiment. And then using thermocouples for measuring temperatures at various locations. And then we looked at microstructure also, that with stirring, we got non-dendritic microstructure, and without stirring, we get dendritic microstructure. This is just examples I'm showing. And we also do CFD modeling, again, for the purpose of predicting how the fluid flow happens during the solidification. And as you see here, when there is high current, then there is a much more vigorous stirring that happens. There's another method with which we have experimented, that is producing billets not by electromagnetic stirring, but just running it over a cooling slope. So the shearing happens actually as it runs down the slope, and then it gets poured into a mold, and the billets can be made using this. So this is a much simpler process. And there are, of course, parameters that we can control to control the microstructure of the billets. So this is something that, again, we don't have to always go for complex processes like electromagnetic stirring. And going through this process, when we do DC casting, this is a DC casting facility that we had, and we cast the billets this is a tun dish, this is the launder, and the electromagnetic stirrer or the cooling slope, it gets fitted just below the tun dish. And then we produce these. Of course, in this case, this is where we see the stirrer, and this is the tun dish. And so billets which have been produced, and we get microstructures. Not all of them were beautiful, but there's some edge effects. We see dendritic microstructure, okay, because of rapid cooling over there. But in general, we get non-dendritic microstructure as we see here. And then after we do heat treatment by induction heating, actually we get almost uniform microstructure everywhere, which is the non-dendritic one that is desirable over here. And then this is the induction heater that we use. We do also, this is another thermal processing which needs to be carefully controlled, because when we do the reheating of this billet, you know, from room temperature all the way to this solidus temperature, we need to control the heating process. And we also need to control the temperature distribution along the billet. It has to be almost uniform temperature distribution before it can be fed into the die casting machine. So this is what we do. If we had done a single step cycle of reheating in the induction furnace unit, the kind of temperature distribution that we get is actually, this is the overall temperature here. If we just expand this one and blow up here, and we see that there is a quite a large temperature difference between the center and the edge at the end of this cycle, which is 19 minutes of heating, and it's about 9 degree difference. And that is quite high if you have to do the die casting, because you need almost uniform temperature, very sensitive to the temperature, because it needs to be in this solidus to liquidus range. So we can modify the cycle, and if you do a three-step cycle, our finally what we get is between the edge and the core is only about 1 degrees. And we can reduce also the cycle time for this reheating. So again, thermal processing is important here. And once we do that, there's another exercise, which is basically CFD simulation of the die casting, the die filling. because we need to design the die for a part. In this case, it is a wheel hub of a two-wheeler. To design the die, we need first a simulation how the metal will flow. And not just metal, this is a semi-solid metal heated to the solidus temperature. And after it is injected here, how it is going to flow and fill the die. So this is an important exercise. I don't want to go into details here. So the die filling, the semi-solid state, again, we can use a software. We have used Flow3D software in this case. And once the prediction shows, these predictions will actually be able to make allow you to fine-tune the parameters of the die casting, preheat and so on, plunger, velocity, everything, so that you get the best product or optimize the product. So this is a solid fraction plot. And once we use this, we are able to produce the part. And this one summary slide shows that starting from the stirring in cooling slope or electromagnetic stirring, making of the billets here with the microstructure, then the heating, induction heating, then making of a die, and then putting into the die casting machine with the die. And finally, we cast these products. In this case, of course, it's a automobile part that will be produced with a desired microstructure. And then finally, these are the mechanical properties, if you see here, with this process, is more or less in the range predicted, or rather in the literature. This is, of course, as cast property. And this is after heat treatment, T6 treatment. And these are the properties that we get. This is, of course, as cast is always, you know, low MPA. And we are more or less, of course, we have shot into the higher UTS strength here. But all I'm showing is that this is the kind of property enhancement that one can get if one, but one can, fine tune the parameters for any desired properties. So with that, I would like to finish this talk, and just with these following points to remember, that thermal process is a key driver in several advanced manufacturing techniques. And the objectives is to achieve the desired properties of the final product based on the parameters. Understanding the physics of the process is key to process design strategy. Modeling is quite crucial for prediction. And this prediction, again, I'll repeat, that implies only the trend, not necessarily exact matching with experiments. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, I will be happy
thank
to.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
I think this lecture on thermal issues in advanced manufacturing, especially you have well explained about the thermal processing and weldments modeling, semi-solid manufacturing, additive manufacturing. We have several questions, sir. That is in a question answer box.
Okay, I will now go to Q&A, right?
Can I pass it, sir, this question?
Yeah, I am looking at the box. You want me to answer each of these, right? Okay. Okay, I think the first question, I'll go with the order. Why electromagnetic forces arise? And how they affect melt pool? Well, the electromagnetic forces arise because of the, you know, electromagnetic coupling, because there is magnetic permeability, then it's because of the basically the Lorentz forces which are there. It's any magnetohydrodynamic effect. So this is basically a magnetohydrodynamic effect. So there has to be a magnetic permeability. Not all materials will experience this, but steel definitely has. Aluminium also has to some extent. So that depends on the those properties of the metals. Okay. Then the GMAW model, is it irrespective of well material and well position? See, the model again, what I have presented is just one model, but there can, because the process is so complex, there is so many different kinds of physics, there are other types of models also. Of course, it is not irrespective of the weld material and the weld position, because I have shown a simple butt welding situation, but there are other definitely weld positions where, you know, the process will be quite different. But what we are trying to show here is the thermal process involved will be similar. But when you do actual modeling and prediction, it will be different if it is other, because there are many, many variants of the of these welding processes. If it is a submerged arc welding, it will be different. It will be a different kind of electrode material, is quite, it can also change the physics of the problem. Then if you reverse the polarity also, it will be different. So, but the basic ingredients in the model will be similar. This is what I thought I would answer. Then how homogeneous is the material in laser alloying? This is a good question. And as I just showed, that any laser alloying, and this will be true for also additive manufacturing, that when we use the laser to melt the material, in the case of additive manufacturing, you are just melting the powder. So it will be homogeneous as long as it melts. But in the case of laser alloying, you have a base material and then you are having a powder. And as I just mentioned, if the melting point of the powder is lower than the melting point of the base metal, then it is more homogeneous. And that is what we have seen. But if it is the other way, if there's a high difference of melting point, then there can be distribution difference in distribution of the other species. And the other thing that can happen is at the solidification front, there is segregation. So once the segregation because of partitioning takes place, it will be homogeneous, but there will be some micro segregation right there. But from as far as macro segregation is concerned, it will be more or less homogeneous if the melting is good for both the species. I can see Professor PK Mishra, how are you, sir? I am very honored to actually your presence. I mean, you are the, you know, I would say the country expert in laser.
So I'm not please, country. Yes, yes. I'm just a maker. Okay.
Yes, sir. Please go
thank
ahead.
You, thank you. It's a wonderful talk. I appreciate.
Yeah.
Because when you design anything, a process or something, this is a must. Either you can prove it by modeling and all these things, or you can feel within yourself. Yes, I feel if this will happen. Once you know the technique, then it will go into the heart and you can see the process instead of validation and all these things that comes. And you have done a wonderful job.
By verifying the technique.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay. Then we can go to the next question. What is the weld position? I think it that same question was asked before, and as I mentioned, that it will definitely depend on the position, but the basics will not change. Modeling will change, but the basics will not. Okay. In species boundary condition, what happens if powder base of the same material as in additive manufacturing? This is, of course, it's a good question. See, normally, if it's the same material, we don't add because what is new that is going to happen. Okay, we will add only if we want to use, if it is not for alloying in that case. But same material we use to build layer by layer, which is basically as in additive manufacturing. Okay, then what happens is we don't give a species you know, distribution as such, or the boundary, depending on how the powder is fed. If the powder is fed just like in the case of alloying, then we will have to use a flux boundary condition, powder flux. Otherwise, if the powder is already there and we are melting, it is almost like a base material melting, except that the texture is different. Yeah, but it's good to consider all these factors before one models. Next is which tool software did you use? Laser surface alloying, we did not use a software at that time, because at that time when we did this, the commercial software dealing with melting solidification, that module was not there. Nowadays, Fluent and many other software, CFS, Flow3D, they do have a good solidification module. But at that time, it was not there. So we had to build our own. And the other reason is there were some models, sub-models which we had to use, like this particle melting and then predicting the effective flux which is distributed. Those things wouldn't have been there in the commercial software. Even now, they will not be there. So, but today, you can use, you can write user subroutines, which we call as user-defined functions, UDFs, and you can put in your own sub-program and then link it with the main software. All these things are possible. Okay, the short answer is that we did not use any simulation software at that time, but today we can use. For more complex processes, definitely we can use. How is thixo casting superior to Rio casting? Thixo casting is not necessarily superior to Rio casting. See, Rio casting is more simple. And if you are melting the material and doing the die casting in a co-located manner, Rio casting is the best way to go for, because you are avoiding the intermediate step of creating a billet and then reheating it. But it has to be done in situ and has to be co-located. And there are other dynamics which we have to be careful, because in the Rio casting, wherever you are storing the slurry, that is the slurry handling, whatever it's called, you have to maintain a certain temperature. What happens is sometimes there is other phase transformation that happens, and the particle agglomeration, the morphologies may keep changing, even though you are maintaining constant temperature in that slurry tank. But that is more or less engineered properly nowadays, not a big problem. Now, where thixo casting may have an advantage is a billet manufacturer, like, you know, a large scale can be done by a typical, you know, billet manufacturer, like a, you know, primary producer of aluminium. And we can get cost-effective billets if it is, you know, if the market is there and if they do it, they can do it over there. They can add to the just one module of stirring to the billet manufacturing. And once large-scale manufacturing is there, then anywhere they want to use, let's say at the component makers, like the automobile component makers where do the die casting, they can simply just reheat those billets and use it for die casting. And consistency in the quality will be much better if it can be done. But in a small scale, it is much more expensive affair. But large scale, if it catches on, but so far it has not caught on, that large scale manufacturing is not done yet. So in small scale, the way it is happening is Rio casting is proving to be a better option. I would say. So that is where, and simpler option that way. Then I think modeling challenges involved with friction stir processing. Friction stir, again, I'm not an expert on friction stir processing. We have done very little work on that. which will have tool pin rotation and thermomechanical selected zone comes into play. I'm not qualified enough to talk about this, but it's the initial process, which is the heat driven process in friction stir processing. But after that, it is a much more complex process where the tool geometry comes into the picture, and then the stirring that happens, and with the plastic deformation, and then distribution of the material. That is too complex. Our group has not worked on it, so I'm sorry I'm not able to feed you with any better insight in that one. Can slope integrated with die caster? Yes, slope can be integrated with the die caster, but there's an intermediate, die handling furnace. Slurry handling furnace that is there. And that has been done actually in CMERI, Durgapur, Central Mechanical Engineering Research Institute. They have a slope integrated die caster, and it is working. They didn't have to modify the die caster, but they had this chain of activity with Rio casting, and it is successfully working. Then flow 3D. In flow 3D, how you're taking heat transfer coefficient? Oh, I see. It's a good question. The heat transfer coefficient we are applying only at the boundary of the workpiece. If you are referring to any melting, like in the welding or so there in the boundary of the workpiece, we go for standard correlations, and it is not very sensitive to that one because it is far away from the center of action, like where we are doing the welding or the laser processing. So the process is not very sensitive to that heat transfer coefficient. So what we do is depending on the conditions that we have, like a vertical surface, heated, constant temperature surface, we estimate what kind of temperature it will be. We go into correlations from textbooks or handbooks, and then we use that heat transfer coefficient. Okay, determination of, I think heat transfer coefficient, that is what I think the question was. But other places, we are not using any heat transfer coefficient, in the melt pool or at the boundaries of the pool. There it is the actual process that is being simulated. So only at the workpiece boundaries we are doing it. Okay, next question is melt pool behavior in terms of melt transportation, same as welding of pure metals when welding of dissimilar materials are performed. It's a good question that, melt pool behavior is governed by the same principles. That is your Marangoni convection, and whether it is dissimilar or similar. But because of the dissimilar properties, thermophysical properties of the two metals, then the extent of melting or the distribution of temperature will be quite different. And that is what makes difference. But the weld pool, that's where the weld pool behavior, melt pool behavior may change because of that. But I think the basic driving principles are same. EM stirring, how are you giving heating? Actually, in EM stirring, we are not giving heating. We are pouring the superheated liquid metal into the mold. And the EM stirrer is fitted outside the mold, which is causing the stirring to happen in the mold. So we are doing actually cooling of the mold from the bottom, so that the solidification process is started as soon as the superheated melt is poured in the mold. So the mold is actually surrounded by the EM stirrer. So the EM stirrer itself is, EM stirrer is just basically a coil arrangement. So we are not putting it inside the stirrer, we are putting inside the mold, and the mold is surrounded by the EM stirrer. So that's what I want to clarify. That answers that question. Are you following ASTM standard for heat treatment of aluminium? We have followed, I don't know which ASTM standard it follows. We have followed standard heat treatment protocols of our, what I showed you was a T6. and I don't know the correlation of the ASTM standard with that. That is, you know, for a certain, for that alloy, it would undergo a certain the phase transformation inside. That is what we would want to achieve. Then the next question is, development advancement can be possible if we increase the accuracy in modeling and viewing the process is happening. This is a good question about in situ viewing of the process. Okay, advancement. Yes, there are many processes which are where the viewing of the process is done. One is in the basic solidification processes. We don't do it for all processes, of course, because it's a very expensive and difficult thing to view, especially metals. In some solidification processes, even we use high energy X-rays in synchrotrons to view basic solidification process, but then again, very thin sections we are able to do. Okay. And definitely it goes into more advanced learning of, and that goes into the model. And in fact, we have used some of these viewing done in the Norwegian, in the synchrotron facility, I think at NTNU or somewhere. I forgot what the name of that synchrotron facility is, but we have looked at those videos also to advance our solidification models. And in the specific case of welding, I think it is Los Alamos National Lab. They have a facility with a powerful X-ray to view the welding process, and they have seen and have correlated many things with the model. But again, this is very, very expensive facility that they are using. But definitely, okay, the next question is, possible to map temperature flowing liquid in slope? Yes, that also has been done. And to a large extent, that work, cooling slope work, as far as temperature mapping and everything is concerned, it has been done at CMERI. It's a different work, it's a different kind of cooling slope, but they have done it. It is possible. Using, of course, simple tool used to do is, one is prediction of temperature mapping, the other is by using IR camera, it is used. And people are trying from no weld joint to reduce the probability of failure. What can be done for it? Many new advancement, people are trying to form no weld joint to reduce probability of failure. What can be done? Basically to avoid joints, yes. And that is actually one of the purpose of additive manufacturing is so that the parts are made without having to go through special joining processes at specific points. So of course, no welding is required is better, but large structures we cannot avoid. So large structures, we need to go into this welding. So the problems we have to live with as far as joining is concerned. So I know research work has to advance, and we cannot do away with welding. This is what I meant, especially for large structures. Yeah, so I think that it brings us to the end of the question. If there's any more, I'll be happy. I hope I have been able to answer most of these questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your informative answers. And
I'll stop the sharing also. Yes.
Faculties and research scholars. Now for a vote of thanks, I would like to call our Honorable Director, NIFT, Professor P.P. Chattopadhyay, sir.
Okay, I will turn on my video.
Yeah, Professor Dattu, I would like to convey our sincere thanks on behalf of NIFT fraternity.
Thank you.
Particular lecture was really unique for many of us, for the particular reason that throughout the lecture, I mean, it was kind of energy source for fusing metallurgical and mechanical science, where NIFT is more focused about, and NIFT wish to pursue the domain of advanced manufacturing at the interface of mechanical and metallurgical science. So I find from very beginning, starting from solidification, encompassing welding, laser treatment, and finally semi-solid processing. That basically highlights how these two domains can fuse together. So that is basically our focus and objective, and particularly people who are looking ahead for advanced manufacturing for metallurgical products at least. So thank you very much for that. It will be definitely enlightening for us to pursue our future endeavor. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome, and thank you for this opportunity. And you know, I've been involved with NIFT thanks to you and Professor Ghosh also to bring me in as part of the team, even to form that. We tried our best to put some input into the curriculum. So this is also another opportunity to interact with NIFT faculty and students. So I'm happy with this involvement.
We are sincerely pursuing the roadmap that has been configured under your guidance, and we believe very shortly we'll be able to have this particular framework in place at NIFT.
Okay, we'll look forward to it. And again, thank you, Professor Mishra, for your presence, and I am quite enlightened. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And today we have another two sessions. The session will be started at 3 p.m. and 5 p.m. I request to all the participants to join and watch this session at scheduled time. Now we announce this session comes to end. Thank you.